Hello and welcome to Faith Matters. Today we're at Liverpool Cathedral for the City Breakfast event, where we have Ruth Hunt, who is the Chief Executive of Stonewall, as our speaker.
I also talked to a lot of you about workplace issues and issues relating to how you include LGBT people in your workforce. This is the first time ever that these two audiences have merged, which is a slightly new experience for me, but we'll go with it. So for those of you who hear me talk frequently about LGBT employment issues, we're going to do God this morning. So I talk very frankly. And I talk very honestly and openly about things that are going on. If you could avoid directly quoting me on Twitter, that would avoid pink news taking that line and attributing it to a really badly written headline that has promised a huge amount of backlash. So the nature of the LGBT community is we have more gay press than there is news. So anytime someone gay does anything, you end up getting it reported. So for the sake of my mother, who ends up reading this below the line, let's try and keep it light, but please do feel able to talk generally about the themes. So Stonewall, for those of you who don't know, was set up 26 years ago in response to something called Section 28. Section 28 was a piece of legislation that prevented the promotion of homosexuality in schools. Ian McKellen, Gandalf, Magento, Richard III, depending on your generation, and his friends decided to set up an organisation. And under the advice of an unnamed Conservative MP, decided to set up an organisation that would be highly strategic, highly diplomatic, very pragmatic, and were committed that no brick would be thrown, no nose would be bloodied in the work to achieve equality for lesbian, gay, and bisexual people. And the objectives were legal change. And Ian McKellen went to see John Major and presented a list of 10 legal changes that were needed for gay people to achieve full equality. And John Major made a commitment to deliver each one of those objectives. At a similar time, a group of trans people were meeting, and they set up an organisation called Press for Change. And those two organisations ran in parallel, working on legal change. Things didn't work out too well for John Major. Tony Blair came in and he made a similar commitment. But even then we were very clear that any equality for gay people, lesbians and bisexual people had to be done on a cross-party basis, that the only way to achieve change was through consensus, and the only way to achieve change was through nudging and gentle steps. So Stonewall made a commitment that we would never be outside a wall shouting, we would always be sitting alongside nudging. And that shapes our culture and our ethos today. And for every move that we make, there is of course a vast LGBT movement who would do it in a different way. And what you would arguably need is all those different approaches. You need shouting and you need banners, but you also need, with the gentlest of hands, polite conversations and nudging. That approach, we now have the best legislation in the world in relation to LGBT people. The differentiation is that we've got rights for lesbian parents that doesn't exist in other countries. That's mainly because the House of Lords didn't fully understand what they were passing. Democracy, and you had me as a lesbian writing, helping lobby on that legislation. And that legislation had words in it that was about changing birth certificates to parent one and parent two, which led to headlines on lesbians abolishing fathers, which we are a powerful force, but not that powerful. But there was a second bit of it that said, from the moment of conception, non-birth mothers would be the second parent of that child. Now that the most controversial bit of legislation in relation to LGB equality. But like all issues of LGB equality, it's issues like marriage and father and these other very powerful and emotive issues that gain the most attention. And actually those are the things that are very symbolic, and actually giving a non-birth partner immediate rights over a child in the moment of conception is truly the most radical. And I share that observation with you because of the way in which civil rights movements work. Civil rights movements are polarized by what seem to be highly emotive and symbolic issues, when actually the real change is going on underneath. So in 2004, the Civil Partnership Act passed. 2004, also the Gender Recognition Act passed, this key moment in legislation for LGBT people. It was around 2004-5 that Stonewall said, okay, we're now going to work to make sure that changing hearts and minds goes on alongside changing the law. Changing the law is only ever one thing. How do we change hearts and minds? And at that point, we developed workplace programs and education programs. We did a huge amount of research into what the needs of LGBT people were. We weren't trans-inclusive at that stage. Press for Change was pursuing that work. And what we did on everything we do is about nudging. So we would go into some of our biggest institutions, some of our biggest players, and say, have you thought about how you might support LGBT people? And we'd have different levels of conversation. And the first stage of conversation, people would say, well, we don't have any gay staff, so we don't need you. Mm-hmm. Those of you who have heard me here will know this before. Second stage, yes, we've spoken to our gay staff and he's really happy. Third stage, yes, we've got an LGBT staff network, and three gay men go to the pub on a Friday and talk about how hard it is to be gay. Fourth stage, yes, we've identified a lesbian and she's going to do all the work. We actually recognise that we have some LGBT staff. And to this day, we continue to work with organisations at those different levels. And our mission is all about transforming institutions, empowering individuals, changing hearts and minds, and changing the law. That's how we work. So for every one of those institutions, we are constantly nudging people through. We want people from stage one to stage five. And we work with 750 major employers. They all pay £2,500 a year, and we help them go from good to great, from stage one to five. We work with 2,000 schools, and we help them go from good to great. We work with hundreds of individuals, helping them connect with their sexual orientation and gender identity and become active citizens in their churches, in their schools, in their communities, where they actively stand up and say, how can I help you make this journey? And we work with allies too. So those who are not LGBT, we help those people say, actually, when you call that computer gay because it's broken, you sound like an idiot. Because the more straight people doing that, the better we are in our society. So where does faith fit into all that? Well, Stonewall didn't do God. We were very clear that matters of religious freedom and religious issues were a matter for faith communities. So every time legislation came through that posed a challenge to faith communities, we left that to faith communities. We were quite clear that no one should be allowed to refuse goods, facilities and services on the grounds of faith. We were quite clear that you can't pick and choose who your customers are. But if churches didn't want to marry gay couples, that was entirely up to them. That was a matter for the church. So what did that mean for me? Well, I started at Stonewall when I was 25. I was younger, scruffy, number three haircut, 20 Marlboro lights hanging out my back pocket. And I was the bright young thing, kind of brought in to do that hearts and minds piece. And at that stage, I was very, very discreet about my faith. I was not out, if you like. But actually, my faith had played quite a part of my growing up. I was brought up Catholic. I was brought up Catholic with an extended family who were all brought up Catholic. We went to Catholic school. And like all Catholic kids, I didn't know much about long division, but I knew my Bible very well. And for me, like all kids, you go to the book that reflects your name, and I learned about Ruth and Naomi. And I loved Ruth and Naomi, and they were very good to each other, and they were very good friends. And there was nothing remotely homosexual about Ruth and Naomi, don't worry. But they clearly valued each other, and they clearly respected each other. So as a school, and as a child, like a lot of people brought up in faith, it was part of my life. It was part of the way we did church on a Sunday, and that was part of what we did. When I was 12 or 13, I realised I might be gay. And that coincided, and I've got a lot of therapy, they're not connected, coincided died in childbirth and left three little kids, a four-year-old, a two-year-old and a baby. And at that point, my life and the life of my family transformed dramatically. Suddenly, at the age of 12 or 13, a difficult teenager, we had three very little vulnerable kids. And those three very little vulnerable kids who just lost their mum went to the same school, and the Catholic Church wrapped itself around us. So what went from part of the furniture as a kid, in the way that churches are, at 12 or 13, became an absolutely integral part of our safety net. I went through life, had saw priests, and I think I might be gay, and they said, well, I remember my priest really clearly said, I think you've got quite a lot going on at the moment, my love. Don't worry too much about that now. How your journey is going on. And I think that was the single most powerful thing that a priest could have said to me at 14. How are your GCSEs coming along? How are the kids? What's it like playing with Duplo again? He was very, very pastoral and deeply caring and deeply compassionate. And therefore, when I hit 16, 17, 18, me being gay didn't really feel incongruous with my faith. I read the Bible again, because that's what you do. So I took a lot from the Bible, but never thought God doesn't love me because I'm gay. It just never occurred to me. That doesn't mean I was naive about what some people were saying. But what faith leaders were saying about homosexuality always felt very male, always felt obsessed about sex, and always felt very distant from my spiritual relationship with God. So what would have been habitual, and then what had come out of crisis and tragedy, maintained its start. I then went to Oxford, as a student, and the thing about going to Oxford is that I was the first in my family to go to university, so already had a massive chip on my shoulder and a sense of anxiety about that. The brash arrogance that comes with a lack of confidence was already growing nicely at that stage. And I was a student politician. You know, I was good at English, and I did politics. I was president of my college, and president of the student union. And I think the thing about going to university is you can't have too many hats. So I kind of did the student politics hat, and then would go to a local parish church. I didn't go to Cathsock. Because if you go to Cathsock, you kind of have to stand up tall on Cathsock. You have to be really good. And I didn't feel a particularly good Catholic, not because of the gay thing, but just because I wasn't a theologian. I didn't understand the politics of the Vatican or anything like that. It was just something that was part of my life. In my second year, we studied modernism and we studied T.S. Eliot. And I remember reading T.S. Eliot, and there's a part in the Four Quartets where T.S. Eliot writes, "Sins for hopefully, but all shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well." And that pushed me to Julian of Norwich, and I read Julian of Norwich, and it was at 20 that I had my adult spiritual moment, where I felt a huge connection with Christian faith and with God. Went back, read all those primary texts, and then as an adult, that's when my faith became affirmed. Now, at that moment, I could have possibly gone, well, actually, I'm going to go to the shop, and I don't quite, you know, Catholics aren't for me, maybe I should go and try the Anglican. But actually, once you're a Catholic, it's quite hard to stop being a Catholic. You know, I believe in the body and blood of Christ, I believe in the one holy Catholic Church, but that sticks. And I didn't want to find a different spiritual home, so I carried on. being Catholic. Time went on, went to university, finished, got my degree, carried on, but was very closeted about my faith. Not because I was embarrassed or ashamed, but because it was private, and it was about my spirituality and what I was doing. Started in Stonewall, we didn't do God, that was fine, carried on doing the work. And then when I was about 27, I was on the media phone. And the thing about Stonewall is we get a lot of media calls at the weekend, so we passed the phone around, and I had the phone. And I'd been out Saturday night, and the phone rang at 8 o'clock on Sunday morning. Hello, we are Stonewall. What does Stonewall think about the closing of the Catholic masses in Soho? And I said, well, it's a real shame because LGBT Catholics require space where they can go and pray. Well, are there any such thing as LGBT Catholics? Yeah, of course, I'm an LGBT Catholic, it's fine. Anyway, thanks very much, bye. Ruth Hunt, Director of Public Affairs, out as Catholic. I thought, because nobody cares about Director of Public Affairs. Then when I became chief exec, the headline that accompanied my appointment was openly practising Catholic appointed head of Stonewall. And suddenly this flurry came, and the flurry that came was from LGBT people. And what LGBT people said was, you cannot be Catholic and gay. why they appointed this mentally ill woman. It's all going to go down the Swanee. It's all going to be about compromise. It's all going to be about being conciliatory to faith communities. It's all a disaster. My poor board and chair were just like, Ruth, we had a lot of worries about what might come out when you were appointed you, but being godly wasn't one of them. And I had a real crisis. I had a real spiritual crisis. And what I had to do is talk to a lot of different people. I also had to talk to my parish priest. The church I go to is a family church in Brixton. It's big. It's a big congregation. And I go for a bit of peace on a Sunday. It's my spiritual home. It's got nothing to do with my day job. And I've got four godchildren, and I go to a different mass with them every month, and I do all that stuff. And I spoke to my priest, and I said, I'm really sorry, I'm in this position now. He said, we are very, very proud that you are part of our congregation, and we're very proud of what you're trying to do. So I had a massive here I am, Lord, crisis moment of what is my role, and knew that I would be asked to speak publicly about Catholicism and sexual orientation. But as then and now, I am not an expert on Catholic politics. I am not an expert on Vatican politics. I think they probably need an LGBT staff network, and I'm very happy to help. The translation of the Greek Bible, White Men in Sodom and Gomorrah, is that about hospitality, or is it about... that's not my patch. It's not my area of expertise, nor do I want to feign an expertise in that. But what I do have is an authentic relationship with my faith. And I believe that our spirituality and our faith shapes our leadership. And I believe in some of the fundamental values that unite Christianity that inevitably shapes the work. So part of my ethos as chief executive is about bringing communities together, is about looking at people kindly, is about helping people move from one place to another, is about welcoming conversations with a spirit of forgiveness and openness, and a capacity to see things from a different perspective. So quite apart from my personal faith, I was absolutely clear that Stonewall should move into this territory, because there had been too much binary notions of what faith and sexual orientation and gender identity meant. There was a perception that if you belong to both communities, you are homophobic, that the church and any major faith organization is fundamentally opposed to LGBT equality, and that never the two shall meet. And we all know that that's actually not the case. There is a vast range of views in the church, as in life, about LGBT issues. That is the nature of society. And there are very different views within the broad umbrella of the Christian church about LGBT people's role in that church. And the issue and the problem is the perpetuation of the notion that all faith communities have a problem with LGBT people continues to perpetuate the hurt and pain that's been experienced. Mm. And it is unequivocal that there has been much hurt and pain experienced by LGBT people at the hands of the church. That is undeniable. But what I find at the moment is that whenever I talk about faith in the public domain, I get a significant amount of abuse from LGBT people, not from people of faith. Because it's those LGBT people who've experienced harm at the hands of the church who find my position utterly disloyal, utterly incongruous, and utterly damaging. And that's what breaks my heart. So how can we find a way through to see where we can break bread together? And to that, Stonewall has made it clear that we need to first amplify the voices of those people of faith who actually are very welcoming of LGBT people in their faith communities, who have found a way to reconcile their spirituality, their faith, their relationship with God, with the fundamental, I believe, Christian acceptance of the diversity of LGBT people and their place in the church. How do we find a way of giving voice to faith leaders to find a way through that? And how, as Stonewall, can we help the Archbishop of Canterbury navigate his way through finding a third way that enables those conversations to take place? So, in the same manner that Stonewall's conducted all its work, nudging, pragmatic, diplomatic, sitting alongside, not sitting outside, how can we together try and move this debate forward? And to that end, Stonewall's playing lots of different roles. We do what we do best. We're making sure that the role models we send into schools are from diverse faith communities. We now have role models who are LGBT from every faith community. We've trained them and spent time with them so they can go into schools and tell their stories. We have a programme where we train teachers in a school, and that teacher trains all the teachers in their school. We're now training people to train that teacher. So we've just trained a Catholic head teacher who will train every Catholic teacher in his diocese about how to tackle homophobic, biphobic and transphobic bullying in the spirit of the Catholic faith. And what that means is that homophobic, biphobic and transphobic bullying is not fair, it's not right, it's not Christian. Now, Catholic schools don't talk about sex anyway. They just need to not talk negatively about gay sex. That's the key, and that's what he says. We are never going to get to a stage where Catholic schools are saying, let me give you the lowdown on safe sex and gay sex. Because they're never going to give the lowdown on safe sex and straight sex, let's be honest. You know, the Catholics are finding their way, but they haven't quite got their head around quite a lot of issues. However, they can say that bullying is not fair, it's not right, it's not Christian. God created all of us, we love and treat all of us equally. And that's part of their pastoral responsibility, and they get that. So Stonewall is trying to empower both communities to play a different role in how they do things. The second piece of work we're doing is we brought together a group of mainly Anglican, some other broader church of England people, and together we've created a movement called the LGBTI Mission, is its current title. It might change, because I don't really like LGBTI Mission, I think it doesn't work, but there we are. Together, what we've done is come up with a 9-point manifesto. And under the headings of living, loving and serving, there are 9 things we want to see changed in how the Church of England works with LGBTI people. And that's about acknowledging that LGBTI people exist and that there is theological diversity around issues of sexual orientation and gender identity. Now, one thing that the Church of England does very well is cope with theological diversity, except when it comes to the gay thing. There is something that prevents a recognition of theological diversity around the gay thing, whereas there's a capability to acknowledge theological diversity in every other respect. So how can we enable greater, better quality conversations about theological diversity around LGBTI issues? How can we look at how youth groups, Christian youth groups, are supporting LGBT people? How can we support different faith leaders to be able to make sure they're not discriminating in the execution of rights? So we hear from lesbian couples who are told they're not allowed their child to be baptized. We hear from parents of trans people whose child has committed suicide and buried in their old name, not their new name. You know, these are really serious issues when it comes to the extension of rights. There is nothing about your views on LGBT people to give you the right to decline a baptism. These are things we should be talking about. Things we should be talking about in relation to the ordination of gay priests, gay people who are in marriages. We don't have to talk about marriage. There are a whole catalogue of other things that we need to talk about that we can nudge forward before we even get on to possibly blessing gay couples at the same time as you bless pets. Yeah? There must be a way in which we can get to a stage where we can acknowledge LGBT people who exist in our rights, in our prayers, in how we work. So this piece of work is a real coalition of different work. It's going to come out just before the General Synod, and it will give everybody an opportunity to think about some of the issues that are not about the polarizing issues of marriage, but actually about how we treat all parishioners, all people of faith, with compassion, dignity, and respect.
Thank you very much for watching Faith Matters here at Liverpool Cathedral. We hope you enjoyed it. Join us next time on Faith Matters.